Hello, Internet. If you're one of the guys that have a similar milling machine and you'd like to go water cooling, there are a couple of things you have to understand before you make that decision. One of the things is whether or not your platform actually supports water cooling. Obviously, this one does. I had a port in the back there, which was complete crap. It was way too small, and so I had to make a larger port, so that way the water that's being delivered can actually escape fast enough that it will not overflow. If you noticed that I'm using guide pins on my on the bed, and so the vise, there's actually a hole that goes all the way through, and so what I'm using is these pins, and I have holes there and holes here, and so I'm putting this you could call it a dowel pin. That's basically guides device. It puts it into position where I don't have to align it every single time. The alignment isn't perfect, but it's near perfect, and that's why I did it. So now that I have these holes, I run into a problem of liquid cooling going down that hole. So I had to plug these holes with something. And so what I did was just a plastic tubing, and inside I made a little bit of a small aluminum insert that is slightly larger than the diameter, so that way when it goes in it fits easily. But as soon as it gets to a point where the aluminum thing is, it's a little bit expanded and it covers it as a plug, and then the nut or the screw on the top that I screwed into the tubing is just, you know, make it easier for me to grab and pull. So I got four of those because I shift the vise either back or forth depending on what I'm doing, so it's easier. With this particular mill here, the issue is that liquid would go past this faceplate, and it would leak down here, so I had to apply some silicone there. For whatever reason, it reacted with the chemical and turned green. I had to do the exact same thing there. You can't really see it, but it was leaking past the seal. So yeah, the other thing is, in regards to the device itself, is that down there, or you can probably see it better on this end, there's a hole here and there's a hole at the front too. So I don't know what this hole is for, but I had to plug it with some aluminum round that I made on my old lathe there. So, and then I just hammered it in. See that hole there? Yeah. So that way it's not leaking. Now the other thing to consider is the pump. I'll show you the pump in just a second. And this pump, at the minimum pumping speed, you may say, is just perfect. It could be even slower. But the problem is, well, basically what you need to concern yourself with is you don't want to blow on the part. You want a continuous, slow, continuous and flooding flow. So that way you don't just blast your cooling onto the part and it ends up flying all over the place. You want to cool your part. You want to flood it with the stuff. So that creates a couple of challenges where all the chips start to accumulate around the part, so you may want to invest into a secondary blower that would, you know, either blow the chips away, but then again, you're dealing with all that splashing. So, I think it's best to just kind of let it flood and not blow anything up, but rather just brush it off with the brush so the chips aren't getting in the way, and at the same time, you're not creating any mess. See, if you start spraying your coolant onto the part, you start creating a mess, and that water's gonna it's gonna go past your vise, it's gonna go everywhere on the table, behind the table, under the table, on your waist. Not good. I'll show you what the cut looks like in just a second. The other thing is, let's see, the switch. I incorporated a simple switch that to where I had to cut off the old connector, and I plugged this male connector here for the pump, so that way I can plug into the female that's inside this box, and then inside there just this little rocker switch, and the AC adapter that came with the pump is actually inside the whole adapter. It's not that really big, it's just so I plugged it in there. I didn't plug it in, I just kind of fixed it with the double-sided tape to the top of the box, and then just wired it in. Throw a switch. So, in order to get good flow of liquid out of your tray or out of the bottom of your platform, is A, you have to have a larger diameter. So in this case, I had to drill a larger diameter, tap it. I think I have went with a 12 M12 1.75 millimeter tap. So that was the largest one I had in my cheap Harbor Freight kits. Let me show you what I got there. Yeah, so this was like the largest die I had. So, and then the largest tap I had was also 12.75. So I just had to go with this size, and it works pretty good actually. So let me show you one other thing is. Well, the other thing is your outlet hose. It needs to be pointing down, or at any point it has to be pointing down, so that it, or basically sitting at the slope. So you can't have this thing sitting like this, and even though your collecting tank is down below, you may end up getting your liquid trapped. So it always has to point down. As long as it's pointing down, doesn't really matter what height it is. So if you were, for example, put it there, even though the liquid level is lower than your platform, your hose still goes up. So, and we're not sucking anything out, we're basically draining it. So in order for this to drain, you know, it has to be below. So the delivery hose really isn't that relevant. So let me show you. I'm gonna show you the pump that I have. I'm gonna take it out. Actually, I'm not gonna take it out. I'm gonna show it to you on a photo. But I will show you the setup that I have. So the drain goes here, and then it goes through a screen, and then if I can get it out. Yeah. And then I have your mama's sock over there, filtering it even more, and then the pump is sitting down there, and that's a submersible pump. So that goes back on here. So the other thing you gotta think about is how much of the stuff you want to add. So you have to add a little more. You have to account, not account, you will see, just turn it on, and let all the lines fill up. So once all the lines are filled and then the water starts flowing, you want to make sure that you have enough liquid there to continuously pump, and you want to add a little bit more, so that way your pump doesn't run dry, because, you know, by the time you fill your platform with liquid all the way to the top, and while it starts running to drain, all that liquid is anywhere but there, so you want to account for that and make sure that you add enough. And speaking of liquid, I chose to go with this thing here. The mix ratio is 38 parts to 62 parts water. That's a very weird ratio. So you could just mix it with one part of the liquid and two parts of water. I used distilled water just to be safe, and I can say that with that mix ratio, 1 to 2, seems like I have no rust anywhere, so I'm pretty happy with that. And so let's turn it on and see what we got. So also one other thing is when you're buying, when you're having to choose which, I don't know, it's like a blower or mistifier thing to go with, I would use this one because it's got a valve. So with this valve, you can control the amount of flow that you get, whereas the other ones, like this one here, yeah, you will see this one where you know you're just the flows with these little knobs. So this one worked okay too, but the problem is that the hose that came with this, or this little snake guy, it was very rigid. I kind of didn't like it, and the inside diameter of the tube was kind of smaller, primarily because it was used for blowing stuff out, so it needed, like, you know, it kind of relied on a high pressure, and we're not dealing with high pressure, we're dealing with low pressure, high volume. So yeah, I would just buy this. This is a lot cheaper. It's not very well made, you know, not as good made as that one over there, but trust me, this one's gonna work a lot better because of this valve. And then, by the way, this top here, I basically unscrewed this and I put a piece of rubber in there and I screwed it back on, so that way this port is completely plugged, so the water is just flowing from there into there, and I gutted everything out of there, so there's nothing in there, just, you know, this. So, and I'm basically maximizing the flow, okay? So that's the idea. You want as much volume of liquid come out. You don't want speed, you want a lot of volume. So that will keep the splashing to a minimal, and it will make the cooling to a maximum. So let's turn it on and see how it works. The way I wired this is I wired it after a switch, so that way I cannot turn on the pump without the unit being turned on. So I'm gonna flip that down, and the pump is already going, so I just open up the valve and there. See, to the maximum flow, that's too much. That's gonna splash. See, you don't want that. That's too much. So let's drop it down to, like, even that's too much. Yeah, a little bit. Very quiet, nice flow. That's what you want to see. And then you can see here that even at the maximum speed, I'm able to evacuate everything, and it's gonna go down in there. You can see the pump is glowing at the bottom, and we're getting a very good delivery. And now we can point it at any angle and run your setup. Okay, so let's put in a block and let's make a cut. So the biggest reason why I wanted to get the water cooling going is to cut the cast iron. And when I cut cast iron, it's very flaky and it just flies all over the place. And the only way to keep it clean, the part clean while cutting, is to use air blower. And if I use air blower, it gets that mist and everywhere and it covers everything. So, let's see how the water cooling works on the cast iron piece. Yep, it works pretty good. I don't see any splashing if I keep the RPM to where I think it should be, and the cut is nice and clean, and I have no dust anywhere, so that's a win. So as you can see, a lot of chips are forming. They're obstructing your view, obviously. So, that's something to consider unless you start blowing on this thing with water. But as you saw earlier, when I ran the machine at higher speed, you could see all the splashing, and it actually made its way all the way in the back, and it was splashing over here. So I would kind of have to make some kind of, shielding screens or whatever to counter that. Otherwise I have to slow the flow down, slow the speed down so it doesn't throw it all over the place. And hopefully this kind of explains to you what to expect when you get into a liquid cooling. But aside from all these side effects with all the splashing and a little bit of mess here and there, the cut is very deep, very smooth. Your bits are gonna last very long, so you get your part done quicker, and a lot cheaper too because you're saving on your bits. And so, but you're paying for it with a mess. So hopefully you guys find this video helpful, and if you did, please give me a like, subscribe for more, and See you in my later videos, and God bless you. Have a good day. Bye-bye.